welcome to La Plaza. His love for his work manifests itself through an inner drive that gives Frank Escalet a unique approach to life, which enables him to confront some of the most difficult obstacles of life with dignity and determination. Tonight's special is a portrayal of this struggling and innovative artist.
As I'm sketching, I don't look at the sketch so much as one thing, if it feels good. And sometimes I'll talk to myself as I'm working, sketching, I say, yeah, feels good, feels good, feels good. And then I know I'm on it. I'm on the right track. It's not, I don't think, very unusual for people to be self-taught. You've got a good amount of folk artists all over the world that are literally their shepherds or their goat tenders or farmers, laborers. And sometimes they'll take a little moment, say on a Sunday when they're relaxing, they'll start sketching or they'll start, you know, painting or so on. And they're quite impressive work that they've turned out. I don't use an easel, by the way. I still use my workbench when I used to work in leather. You know, the same, I'm so used to it for so many years that I still paint on the bench. And I let the pencil wander, I let it take off by itself. Then eventually I see something and I'll pick up on it and I'll start follow through. And before you know it, I've got a subject matter. I used to sneak into the museum simply because I couldn't be seen or tell my buddies that I'd be going there because I automatically would have been called a sissy. You see, so I used to go and nobody used to look. I used to sneak over there. And my eyes was as big as saucers when I used to see these big fire engines that were hand pulled and hand pumped by the firemen of, say, of the 1840s. You know, when I was a boy, again, we're going back to Spanish Harlem, I was making model airplanes. I'd get some brown paper, mostly, you know, a shopping bag, and draw my own plans of an airplane. Start right from scratch. I would be my own engineer. And I would design, not only design this thing, but build it. And they flew. I don't know how, but they flew. So I started making these planes where somebody else wasn't that handy with their hands, and I used to sell it to them. From there, I came out, went to school under the GI Bill after 3 years in the service, And while there, under the GI Bill, which I was taking automotive mechanic, that was back in 50, the Korean War broke out in June. And they call it police action. I didn't have a worry in the world about being drafted or anything because I had already put in my 3 years, you know. Consequently, I felt that I need to travel again. And I went back, and I knew this time I'd be sent overseas. The last time I was throughout the southern part of the United States and et cetera, it wasn't too exciting. Lo and behold, they sent me to England, where I spent 3 years there, and it was really memorable for me. I really had a fondness of the country, the culture that they had. I linked up with a fellow who used to come in. I used to service his beat-up Plymouth. He had the seats tore out, and he was using it as a truck, pickup truck. And he was into working with copper, you know, metal. And I was fascinated. So, of course, I went with him and wasn't sure from week to week whether I'd be getting a paycheck or not. But I picked up with him, and he taught me a few things, you know, on working with metal. And I went from there into becoming a silversmith. And in 1956, the beginning of 56, I got my first little shop, and I set that up. And I hung up my shingle, you could say. I was a silversmith, you know, a jeweler. Profitable to make a leather bag than it was to say make a sterling silver ring or what have you. It was more demand for it, so of course I became a full-fledged leather craftsman. I held that for about 17 years, taught a lot of people the trade, and had quite a few people towards the end before I left New York. I had five salesmen and a couple of helpers, you know, full-time. I mean, we were open 7 days a week.
We moved together. We built a loft. We rented a loft in the Bowery right above Chinatown. The rent was $80 a month. And he sanded all the floors, rosewood floors. And we had floor-to-ceiling windows at either end. And in the center is where we lived. We had sections that he built rooms. And on either end, we each had a studio. The village was, it is now changed, but it will never be what it was. I mean, the rents are outrageous now, but it was just a wonderful place to live. You could walk at 3 a.m. on a Sunday to get the New York Times, and I would walk with the dog. And there'd be lovers strolling, or people coming out of parties, or other people going to get the newspaper. And of course, after he worked, he always went out, had a few beers just to unwind and listen to jazz. It was just a totally different time.
New York became unbearable because I was at that point in 1968. I had my real pride and joy, Danny, my son, was born, and I felt that it wasn't the right environment for him, or for that matter, any child to be brought up in New York. You know, there was a tremendous amount of, you know, of crime and so on. So I packed everything up at one time, and trucked it all the way up to Maine, where I set up workshop again. I noticed that most people have a tendency of, when they do see it from a distance, they think that it's a painting. They assume it's an oil painting or, you know, acrylic or what have you, until they get up close, and then I would tell them that it's leather. Next thing they automatically do is that they touch. They reach out and start to touch it. They want to, you know, that's an automatic, a human reaction towards that, you know, respond anyway. And they would touch it, so now it became pleasant.
From the very beginning, when he started the leather inlaid pieces, I knew he would gain world fame for the simple reason I loved his artwork to begin with, but it was a medium that no one was really into.
Cutting something that's with precision, and at the same time, it moves on you. Leather is like a rag. Yet you have to take that clean cut and be specific with it. Now, after you go through curves and everything, you're cutting this piece out. This is where previously I had 17 years of being a master craftsman with leather came in. So now you have a combination of being a master craftsman, then bring it into another plane and making it into an art form. After I had started the leather inlay, 1976, I had the one of the pieces that I that was to me the grand moment, even to date, was a piece that I've called Carnival in Rio, which is 4 feet by 8 feet. I knew that I had a tremendous project in my hands, something like I've never ever handled before. I used to be on my hands and knees working the pieces continuously, with occasionally getting up and cutting on the bench. Once in a while, after working at it for an hour and a half, I would have to try to get back my circulation, so I would lay on my side, roll over on my side in a fetal position, and stay that way. And it was so painful of trying to stretch up, trying to straighten myself up, my body as it went along. I would straighten out my legs and everything, and
we had to help him up once.
Stand up eventually and just straighten it. I mean, straighten out my whole body, which is still, you know, I was hunched over. I felt that, you know, the more of a challenge something is, the more fanatical I become. There's a tremendous drive within myself that I will not stop. I will not let it beat me. It became then a total war between that piece and myself. This was every day working, you know, the 12 hours solid. Towards the end, I was really fading fast. I felt that my heart was going to give out on me there. Then it became really a desperation. I kept pushing. I knew that I was even past my limit, but I kept pushing, even despite that. It became so, the pain psychologically didn't exist anymore. You know, it was past that pain, and I kept at it and kept pushing it, and I was almost begging inside, almost screaming inside, and I said, I've got to finish it. I've got to finish. I can't stop now. I went up north, Washington County, and I got taken in by the beauty. I mean, it was nature in a raw. It was really fantastically beautiful up there. One of the funny things up there was that there's an Indian reservation, you know, Passamaquoddy Indians. And I picked up a few words, by the way, up there, Indian words. And they were coming over to my workshop. As you know, there was a government program that was where they could be taught different things, you know, different projects or any subject matter or what have you. And I signed up for it. And I taught them, which is funny, myself teaching an American Indian leathercraft, all right? But that's the way it worked out, you know. And I had a nice workshop up there, you know, and so on. But it was still hard because realistically, there wasn't much of an opportunity to make a living up there, you know.
And there are several others that I don't think you even have, that he doesn't even have slides of, which are the real strong ones, which are on the African series.
Yeah.
1 year, I think our total income was $1,171 for five people. That was a hard year. And our mortgage payment was $74.34 a month. But we managed. This is from good friends who were at the fish factory. No one liked codfish up there. We loved it. That's bacala, you know. And we ate fish, which was healthy. And the vegetables that we grew. And some of the friends we had up there from Pleasant Point and several that were in town.
Years up there, and the friends that we did have up there, you could count in one hand, because they were very, very extremely backwards people. You know, they were really backwards. And if there's anybody who comes from away, from the outside, and settle there, they have a hard time. They don't have it easy. Consequently, my boy, when he went to kindergarten, we learned that he was a baby, but when it was time for him to go to school, he went to school, and I mean, he was literally tortured by all the other, you know, other kids, and of course the older grades. He was always coming home with broken, you know, his clothes being ripped and so on, and hurt and what have you. And he kept that up, and, you know, that went on for a few years, where at one point he had a fractured and they made him stand on it in school, a hairline fracture, and we sued the town, and won, settled out of court. But I said, this, you know, you can't educate, you know, people if they're that ignorant, and consequently we got out of there, but not before he was damaged mentally. I guess he didn't think too much of himself. He was really depressed, and he got into drugs and drinking, and he was very depressed, and he did himself in. It's 2 years now, Lou. 2 years has passed when he killed himself that way. It just left me frustrated, because I wouldn't mind if he'd gotten in the service, gotten killed in any form or manner while doing his, you know, duty, whatever, whichever way. But not this way, not a suicide. That's You go through life carrying the thing of asking yourself, how could I have prevented it? What could I have done? And you torture yourself the rest of your life this way. It's a thing that you have to bear, you know. But we bear it, and I go every day. I think of him, and I say, I love you, Danny. I first started working in wood on the sculptures. And this came about by having available materials that was laying around through some of these building sites that was all being carted away and being just trash, you know, removed. I would scavenge pieces. And I started from that. There was paint that was even thrown out. I'd be scavenging anything that was available. Copper pipes, copper, you know, pieces of sheet metal, galvanized, everything. It's very challenging because I don't plan any of this. I let it happen. And it's mostly, as a rule, it happens by being dictated by what materials are available, what's on hand. I took that car and resurrected it. It was abandoned, and I've used it, and I've had it for 10 years. It's done me very good service. It's a 68, and one of these days I will eventually, take it completely apart and restore it. One of the things I did that I had to do quick because it really looked awfully bad was giving it just a quick paint job at one time, cleaning it up, taking most of the rust off, and making it look a little more decent, you know. I had in mind a burnt orange. I felt that was a deep, you know, rich, rich color. And of course, when we were painting, this fellow that was doing some spraying with me and so on, he and I were working on the body, he was totally shocked, you know. And he just, you know, I mean, it just blew his mind that there was a vibrant color that was being used. Little did he know that it was, that I also was thinking about maybe a purple.
You know. In my solitude, you haunt me with reveries of days gone by. In my solitude, you charm me with memories that never die. Yes, I sit in my chair, I'm filled with despair. There's no one could be so sad. With gloom everywhere, I sit and I stare. I know that I'll soon go mad. In my solitude, dear Lord above,